Hi friends, let's take another question, how to deal with a continuous feature value. So I have already created one video on how to deal with a discrete feature value. So in this tutorial we are going to see about what are the different ways you can deal with if you have a feature which is continuous in a nature. So let's try to first understand what is discrete feature and what is the continuous feature. So let's take one example. Like suppose your feature contains only finite number of values like a male, female. So it can contain only maximum two values like male or female. So it will classified as a discrete value. But if you say like a age of the person or even height of the person, that will be classified as a continuous feature value. So I have already prepared one video how to deal with this discrete feature, and I will put the link in a description, so you can straight away and go and watch how to deal with the discrete value while dealing with the machine learning algorithm. So in this tutorial we are going to see how we can approach if we have a values like how we can analyze if you have a feature value which is continuous in a nature like a age of a person or even a height of the person. So let's try to understand with respect to one example, and let's try to discriminate between if you want to analyze the same feature or a same data from the discrete value point of view or a continuous value point of view. Let's take one example. Like we have a data about people who got the job. So we have a people or employment data who got the job. Now let's try to analyze this thing from the two different perspective. So one is the gender. So based on the gender, if you want to classify the people who already got the job or who are applying for the job, you can straight away classify like a 50% are male and 50% are female. So this way, or even you can say 70% are male and 30% are female. So there is a maximum two possibility exist by the gender. But suppose the same people who if you want to classify with respect to age, so there is a infinite value ideally exists, but even if you take it as a finite number of step, then also there is a huge number of age. Let's take the range is starting from 15 to the somewhere around 50. So there is around 35 around ages are exist. So there is a number of way you can analyze those things, and that won't be a straightforward like while you are analyzing data based on your gender. So there are number of techniques like a binning. You can create the new feature when you are dealing with the continuous value, normalization, outlier, PCA, that is the acronym for the principal component analysis, factor analysis. You can even transform those data when you have a very skewed transform on a left side or on a right side. You can apply log kind of transformation on the top of when you came across some feature which is having a date time value. So how to deal with those kind of thing, let's see one by one. So first one, we'll take it as a binning. Binning is equivalent to the, you can say, histogram. So first one is histogram. So let's take our previous example only. So we have let's say 100 different people who got the job, and all those people's age we know about it. So let's take age is somewhere around 23 34 63 12 32. So this way, so on, we have a age of around 100 people. So what happens in a binning, it is equivalent to the histogram. You can keep creating different buckets. Let's say we know about the range of the people, range of the ages of the different people who got the job. So range is like starting from 10 to let's say around 60. So you can create five different buckets. So one bucket will be around 10 to 20, another will be 20 to 30. Then a 30 to 40, and lists will go so on. So this way you are putting how many people who lies between the age 10 to 20, how many people age lies between 20 to 30. This way you are trying to get the frequency of the people who lies in a particular bucket. But there is a one problem with this. how to decide those kind of bucket. If you decide a very small bucket like a 10 to 12 only, 11 to 15 only, in this way the buckets is small, in that case the loss of information will be very less. But if your bucket is very much bigger one, then loss of information will be very high. So it's up to you how you are defining your bucket to analyze your data, and that is nothing but the histogram. Okay, let's take another example or another way to analyze the continuous data, the creating new feature. Now what does the creating new feature is? Let's say you acquire already the new all those data, and let's take one very specific example to understand how to create those new feature. Sometimes it happens that you came across the situation where you can artificially or you can recalculate some new feature based on some existing feature. We will take one example of the Boston house data set. So we have a house price data set, and in this house price data set, let's say we have total three columns. One is the length of the house, one is the width of the house, and one is the price of the house. So that is nothing but the room length and room width I am just talking about to give you an example. So based on the length of the room and a width of the room, it is been calculated as a what is the price of the predicted price or actual price of the particular house. So you can say that this length and width you can combine and you can create another feature like a area. So area will be nothing but your width into height. So that way you can artificially generate the new feature, and those new feature will be will become another independent variable to predict your new variable like a price. So this way you can create the new feature to create your hypothesis. Let's take another example like a normalization. So what does the normalization means? We'll take one example like the student who got the math grade, and another is the same set of student who got the science grade. Now we got the results of individual students whose performance in a math exam and a science exam. So we'll get some marks like a 12, 13, 16, 24 or somewhere around, and science also we got somewhere around 56, 23, 67, and list will so go on. Now if you try to analyze this continuous feature of math grade and a science grade, you can see that the student has performed very bad in case of a math exam, but they perform quite well in a science exam. Now if you try to compare these two, that is not obvious. Your base should be to compare the individual student math grade and a science grade, because it may happen that whatever the science grades were coming, that is out of just the 25 maybe. And whatever the science marks are coming out of 100, so that is not a very much obvious base to compare that whether the student have performed well in a math or a science. So in that case the normalization technique will be very helpful, that you try to normalize every single data on the base of 100 or on the base of 1 sometimes, or even a base of 10. So take all those data or individual feature, you try to calculate the mean and you centered around all those data around the mean and divide by the standard deviation. So whatever the value after that you will get, that is nothing but the normalization of the data. Once you normalize all those data, in after that only you can compare the individual student math and science grade, and you can very well say that particular student or list of student have performed well in a math and science. In that case, in this case you can't perform directly, because all those marks has been obtained in a science out of 100, and in a case of maths it is out of 25. So that is not, that should not be our base to directly compare. That's why this normalization process is required to do. Let's take another way to dealing with this continuous feature value, and is the outlier. Now what is outlier? So while acquiring or while collecting data, what happens sometimes that there is a some list of value or some particular value which just goes beyond our particular normal range of data. So it may happen that, let's say you are acquiring the age of the particular student, you are getting like a age like a 12, 40 or even 20, somewhere around. Suppose somehow by acquiring collection, the process has some human erroreness will be introduced in that particular place, and you got the age like a 200. So that is not acceptable as a human being, because we haven't seen anyone whose age is around the 200. So that is being considered as an outlier, and there are a number of techniques available to detect particular outlier. That you try to find the mean and how much data particular has been situated around the mean to the extent of at least the 3 standard deviation or 2.5 standard deviation, and the data which goes beyond that 2.5 standard deviation you can consider it as a outlier. So that is a one matter. You can even try to visualize those data with a box plot. I'll show you the what is box plot here. Let me just Google it and I'll show you what does the box plot to detect the outlier. Let's take one image. Okay, so this is the box plot. So you can say that this is the example of number of eggs laid. So the whatever the horizontal line is there, that is the maximum range, and whatever the two dots you are showing, that is a minimum 2x and maximum is a 10x, and whatever the vertical line you are watching, that is nothing but the mean of the your number of eggs laid feature, plus whatever the rectangle you are seeing, that is nothing but the around the mean this much amount of data has been situated from 3 to 8. Now suppose somehow you got some data which has a number of x laid around 50, so that is not considered as a lying in a very usual range. So that is been considered as a outlier, and this box plot will be very helpful to visualize that particular feature, that where your particular distribution of data lies, and if data of that distribution lies beyond certain range, and if you think that should not be a part of our further data analysis process, you can immediately discard those particular feature. So that way you can deal with the outlier. So we have seen about how to deal with continuous feature with respect to the meaning matter, how one can create the new feature, normalization and outlier. And now we are going to see about the PCA factor analysis and transformation, and how to deal with the date time feature. So that's all about this lecture, friends. I hope you enjoy listening this video. In the next tutorial we will see about the another 4 matter to deal with the continuous value. At last, thank you guys for the watching.